ओम नमः शिवाय स्टूडेंट्स स्टूडेंट्स इन टुडेज़ क्लास ऑफ मास मीडिया स्टडीज ऑफ क्लास 11 वी विल बिगिन विद द सेकंड चैप्टर फ्रॉम योर यूनिट 4 प्री प्रोडक्शन स्किल्स स्टोरी एज अ सब्जेक्टिव एक्सपीरियंस. नाउ स्टूडेंट्स यू ऑल नो दैट अ स्टोरी कैन एग्जिस्ट इन वेरियस फॉर्म्स लाइक इट कैन बी अ लॉन्ग स्टोरी, इट कैन बी अ शॉर्ट स्टोरी, इट कैन बी अ ड्रामा, वेदर इट कैन बी अ नॉवल ऑल्सो. इवन द फिल्म्स दैट यू वॉच दैट आर ऑल्सो स्टोरी बेस्ड. So the stories can exist in various forms. Now the next point to be talked of over here is art is subjective. Now students see how art has been defined here. The use of skill and imagination in the creation of aesthetic objects, environments or experiences that can be shared with others. Very important to be noted that can be shared with others. So that means art which is being created by one creator, it can be shared with others. So when any piece of imagination that can be shared with others, we call it a form of art. So story is also a form of art. Thus story writing or telling story through any medium is art. Hence we are sharing one's imagination with another or others. It can be said that story is also a form of art. And art is subjective as it is a very personal expression of one's thoughts and feelings. Now students, just think about yourselves also. Whenever you are given to write a story in your English, in your subject English, you get it. You are told to write a story based on the storyline, or you are given some hints that you have to develop into a story. Now definitely, though there is a key word or a key hints, but the story you people develop differs from one to another. Why that? You just think, no. Why it happens? Because each and every individual thinks in their own thought process. They think through their own thought process. They apply their own experiences. They apply their own imagination power, and hence a story can be created. So this is called the subjective experience. You can say a subjective experience refers to the emotional and cognitive impact of a human experience as opposed to an objective experience, which are the actual events of the experience. So, how you feel about a game, that is your subjective experience. But how many runs are scored in the game, that is definitely objective experience of the game. Are you understanding the difference now? What is the between the subjective experience and objective experience? Now, the hints that were given to you, definitely those are same. But the production, the product that has come out, that is definitely differing from one to another. And it is only because of the subjective experience of the individual. Now, as Somerset Maugham has beautifully put that, a writer cannot be far removed from what he writes. Because a writer cannot be removed far away from what he writes. Such beautiful expression, isn't it? Because a writer is only penning down his thoughts, his own experiences, his own ideas, his own imaginary power. Okay, so that's why, according to this famous writer also, a writer cannot be far removed from his writing. Now students, as I told, what is subjective then? Subjective may refer to subjectivity, a subject's perspective, particular feelings, beliefs, desire or discovery made from information pertaining to a personal experience or understanding of it. Means you are given us particular information and you are thinking it according to your own thought process, or you are thinking it according to your own line. Okay, now then you are delivering or you are creating according to yourself. So that's why the information is given to you and you are pertaining it to your own personal experiences and your own understanding, and hence you are exhibiting that, and that is called the subjective experience. Thus, the nature of person along with his background plus his reactions with social events are important factors to be studied or considered while evaluating a writer's works. It's very important, no? That's why we have lots of genres in English literature also. We have seen the ages. So many ages. Old English age, Romantic ages, Victorian ages, Jacobean period. All those periods are also there. Why? Because though the writers of a particular age were affected by the scenario of his or her particular ages. That's why there has been differences in their writing style also. Now students, you will get innumerable examples to show that art is subjective. The popular ones would be the painting of the Last Supper by Salvador Dali and Da Vinci. Both are paintings of the same event, but they're distinctly different thanks to the interpretation of the event by the artist. So this is a single piece of painting, that is Last Supper, but two different painters has painted them and they have interpreted. They have drawn it according to their own interpretation, and that's why the difference lies in a picture. Now students, I would tell you all to search the Google and look into the image that has been there. Look at the portrait. Moving on to storytelling within the context of a subjective experience, let's take the example of the film Story of Devdas. Devdas, the novel, was written in 1917 by Sarachandra Chattopadhyay and was made into film in 1935 by P.C. Barua, in 1955 by Bimal Roy, in 2002 by Sanjay Leela Bhansali, and in 2009 by Anurag Kashyap. Interestingly, the story of the same hero is told and perceived differently by each and every film story writer when compared with the original book, depending upon their subjective viewpoints. Now, the way the author has actually written that, he has written it from his own perspective, and when these filmmakers have created their film, they have also created it from their own perspective. That's why though the story may be same, but the film that has been created surrounding the same story is different, because the writer, the filmmakers are all different. They are no single individual. They are different entities, and hence the difference lies. You are understanding why a story is called a subjective experience? Now students, this is a task for you, okay, where you are asked to illustrate any of the stories according to your own experiences. Moving on to now another form of story, haiku. As we have talked of, haiku is a form of short poems from Japan that has got popularity all across the world now. With the translations of haiku into various languages and an understanding of the essence, this form is being practiced in various languages of the world. Look at the over here. In this solid mist, what are those people shouting between boat and hill? Okay, so the haiku is a 17th syllable in Japanese poetic form that has been practiced in Japan for 300 years. So haiku is a very ancient form of art. A haiku is not a complete poem in our usual sense, but rather an audio-visual sketch that the reader is supposed fill in with his memories and associations. So haiku is only giving you a guideline, and you have to run your own thought process. The reader is expected to seek the connection through his imagination and sensibilities. Another important feature of a haiku is that it holds a keyword that is related to a season. Over here you can get the keyword mist. Okay. The word could be the name of the season itself or a seasonal reference that can be easily understood. Like example, the image of a frog jumping into a pond is associated with summer in Japan. Okay, so haiku, in the writing of haiku, you will get a reference. You will get a keyword from where you have to understood what is the actual essence of the writing. Now, the season in the haiku given above is autumn. Definitely, mist is associated with autumn. Taking the main idea of the haiku given above, as you will see, it developed this idea further into one-page story or a description of an action that should contain the broad details of what the situation is, who are the characters, where is the action taking place, and at what time. Now students, if you do this practice, if you compare your writing with others, you will see, though a key element has been given to you, though a key word in the haiku has been given to you, but you will again interpret it in different ways. Why? Because again of the same thing, because of your subjective experience. So we can say haiku is a form of art, and it is also because of a subjective experience. And why this happens? This happens because we all read a story subjectively. Each one would read the haiku in his or her own way, as that would become his or her starting point in constructing the story. That is why we have different stories told by different writers in different styles. Even though they may have been triggered by the same or even similar initial idea. So that means the trigger point or the stimulus of a single piece of writing may be same, but the production or the product that is being created is just different because of the subjective experience. Now moving on to two beautiful poems written by William Wordsworth and William Blake, though on the same point, though on the same topic, London. Students, you will see in the first poem, that means composed upon Westminster Bridge, September 3, 1802, written by William Wordsworth, you will get to know about the beautiful picture of the city London. Whereas in the next poem, London, written by William Blake, you will get to see a very rude look of the same city London. Now students, why? Because it is only because the difference is very, because it is subjective experience. Because Wordsworth presents a very positive picture of London, unlike to his contemporary poet William Blake, who portrayed a very negative and sadistic picture in his poem London. Why? Because Wordsworth, you all know, was one of the major poets of the Romantic movement in Britain, and his poetry is generally focused on nature and man's relationship with the natural environment. Many of his poems are focused on the landscape of the Lake District, paying particular attention to the power of nature and the ordinary living people and working on the land. This poem is perhaps a little unusual for Wordsworth, as it takes the city of London as its subject, and his is a fleeting impression of the city of someone who does not live in it. So Wordsworth is giving the expression of someone who is further not living. He is giving the description in such a way. Whereas Blake's poem was published during the upheavals of the French Revolution, and the city of London was suffering political and social unrest. So you can imagine of the situation. There was an unrest in throughout the entire city. At that time he was writing the poem, or we can say his writings are affected by such times. So due to the marked social and working inequalities of the time, the city of London was a town that was shackled to landlords and owners that controlled and demeaned the majority of the lower and middle classes. Blake lived and worked in the capital, so had the first-hand knowledge and experience of the life in the city, and was arguably well-placed to describe conditions under which people lived there. Dangerous industrial conditions, child labor, prostitution and poverty are just some of the topics Blake explores. Here is another poem on London by Francis William Dorrible. So over here also you will get to see a picture of London, a cruel picture of London. And this is also the same reason, because the particular poet, that Francis William Dorrible, he has also made a dramatic and remarkable story. Why? Because he was a brilliant young writer who championed the cause of nationalism and socialism in Australia in the 1880s. Knowing his life would be unfairly brief because of the tuberculosis, he burned with passion and energy, playing a significant role in shaping and reflecting Australia's literary, social and cultural history in the years leading to Federation. His six most productive years, 1884-1890, were spent in California, Australia, quickly and enthusiastically embraced by the Australian radical press. He became highly influential as a social analyst and commentator. His poetic work participates in both the bush writing of the Australian 1890s and the aesthetic decadence of the English finnacle. He also wrote a number of novels. So, because of the background, so because of the time to which a particular poet or author is belonging, their writing are also affected in such a line. And again, the same thing to talk about, that it is only because of the subjective experience. Now students, over here, you are supposed to make a search about the Kala Ghoda region of Mumbai, and you are also asked to read a poem. Read the poem Kala Ghoda Poems by Arur Kolakatar. And how you feel, what are your notions after reading the same, you are supposed to pen it down. Now coming to a story by Anton Chekhov, A Male Factor. Let me brief you the story. The storyline says like this, that the story is opening with Denis Grigorov, a small and poor peasant, standing before the magistrate. The magistrate invites Denis to come forward and answer his questions. It was reported by a railway watchman, Ivan Isevanovich Akinvov, that in July of that year, Denis was unscrewing a nut by which rails are made fast to sleepers. The magistrate is interested in Denis' reasoning behind his action. Denis is a simple, uneducated man, and answers the questions in such manner that the magistrate often feels he is being made a fool out of. Eventually, Dennis admits he did unscrew the nut, but everyone in his village does that. The peasants use the nuts as weights for fishing, and it does not occur to them that their actions could cause serious accidents. After the hearing, the magistrate decides that Dennis should go to prison. Dennis does not understand why he should be imprisoned, why he should be imprisoned, because in his eyes he did not do anything that would deserve such a severe punishment. At the end, he is taken to prison. Now, student, this is the brief storyline of this short story, A Malefactor by Anton Chekhov. Now, after you go through the story in detail, you are supposed to solve this question that is given here. Is it just an amusing story of you discover something more from it? It is up to you. Describe the main character Dennis as you see him. Do you think such characters or situations could exist around you today? So you are supposed to make an analysis of the story, as I have told the briefing of the story. Then you are supposed to note down the answers. So with this, we completed this chapter. Thank you. Om Namah Shivaya.